Now we would like to move to our second most interesting subject, that is journey towards outer space. Well, we do up to, the journey outer space by aeroplanes. We have lucky to get Wing Commander Rakesh Sharma over here for this, subject. I find that Wing Commander Rakesh Sharma, born in 1949 at Patiala, completed schooling from his grammar school, Hyderabad, after short span in Nizam College. He was selected for National Defense Academy, Kharagpur, in 1966. Graduated from NDA in 1968 after completion of flying training, commissioned into Indian Air Force as a fighter pilot in 1970. Flew 21 operational missions on MiG-21 aircraft during Indo-Pak War in 1971, was selected for the production test pilot course in 1975, and later in 1979 graduated as an experimental test pilot from the Indian Air Force Test Pilot School at Aircraft and System Testing Establishment in Bangalore. Served as an Air Force test pilot for 15 years, during which period was selected for the joint Indo-Soviet space mission 1984, which culminated in an 8-day near-Earth orbit space flight, was awarded the Ashoka Chakra by the Indian government and the Hero of the Soviet Union and Order of Lenin by erstwhile Soviet government. He was seconded to the industry in 1987 and served as chief test pilot to Hindustan Aeronautics Limited. During this period, his skills were extensively utilized on the country's prestigious light combat aircraft project and HAL Intermediate. I believe the most lucid biodata, and I believe he is the fit person for the space and air journey. Because he is born as an airman right from the birth. And now I request Wing Commander Rakesh Sharma to deliver his speech on outer space.
Thank you, Anand Kumarji, for your introduction. And I must say, I've had a very fascinating journey into inner space from Professor Swami. Can you hear me there, right at the end? Okay. So we are now going to shift gears, and from inner space, we'd like to come out and start our journey towards outer space. And unlike the light which we saw during our journey in inner space, we need darkness to look at outer space. Outer space is all dark. But before I begin, I must introduce myself. What you heard, of course, were the opportunities which I had got. But it would perhaps be better to begin with letting you know who I am not. Well, I'm not a scientist in the true sense of the word, although most of my life I've been dealing with applied science. And I'm also not a spiritualist, again, in the true sense of the word, though I believe that I lead a spiritual life. Well, I am actually one who has led a very charmed life, one who has willingly got whatever he has wanted. I wanted to be a fighter pilot flying fast jets,
and I became one at the age of 21. For my 23rd birthday, I had actually flown 21 missions in the Indo-Pak War, as you had heard. In the presently much maligned MiG-21 aircraft. My growth in the Indian Air Force was steady, nothing spectacular. And I started dealing with the applied science, as I had said, when I was selected for the production test pilot's course. And the following year, I started testing the brand new MiG-21 aircraft, which used to flow off the production line. And at the end of that tenure, I upgraded and became an experimental test pilot. This was a qualification with which I was permitted to test aircraft which I had never flown earlier. And indeed, those new designs which were flying for the very first time after coming off the drawing board. After a few more years of service, the unthinkable happened, and my colleague Ravish Malhotra and myself got chosen for the space flight. And it was a most memorable experience. And this happened in the year 1984. I returned to Nasik as the chief test pilot there, which is when I met Dr. Sri Khande, when he visited there to meet with one of his patients. And we have had very interesting interactions ever since then. And I'm here today addressing this distinguished gathering at his request. Quite frankly, I was not very keen to accept, only because I'm not well read in the subject of spirituality. And I have no hesitation in admitting this, because this is such a homely and informal group. But today, I intend to share with you some of the insights which I and my colleagues, my astronaut and cosmonaut colleagues, who have gained from our experience when we undertook the journey to outer space. And I shall be conveying this to you through the medium of a PowerPoint presentation which I have put together. And thereafter, I would also like to share with you my own concern, along with those of other members of the Association of Space Explorers, about the future of our planet. And this again comes through very powerfully in a 20-minute video clip which I shall be projecting. Let's get on then with the slide presentation. We will share this experience, and I'll try and take you on this journey. So strap up. And once we get there, I will try and explain to you what it is we do when we go up into space. And also, like I said, I will share the concern I have about the future of our planet Earth. Now, this format will be loosely structured, and it will be highly informal. Firstly, where are we? Where are we in terms of space exploration? And how do we go about it? I'm not going to deal with the training aspects because it's a bit long drawn out. And next, what is the future like for our planet Earth? This is the launcher which takes you into space. And if you look at this area over here, this is the business end of the launcher. And this is these are the solid rocket boosters on the side. And this is constitutes the first stage, whereas the one in the center is the second stage. And all of these are developing all that amount of thrust which is needed to get up into space. Here it is on the launch pad. It's 150 feet high, and the crew is sitting somewhere over here at that time. Now, remember that you are unable to see outside because there is a shroud which is covering the porthole. And all the information which you're receiving is through the headphones. And at launch, all you get to hear is a lot of rumbling inside, a lot of noise. And all the side supports are removed, so as the journey begins, there is, you're right here, 150 feet high, and even the slight sideways swaying movement is highly exaggerated, and the control system, you know, is trying to keep you upright and keep you going. So you don't want to make its job difficult by trying to shift around in your seat, so you just freeze and hold your position. And as speed starts building up, you're starting from zero, and you accelerate in about 500 seconds to a speed of 8 kilometers per second. And this kind of an acceleration, of course, pushes you deep into the seat, and the G-forces start piling on, and your body weight starts increasing because of the G-forces, and you have difficulty breathing because your rib cage is also weighing 5 times as much, so you're unable to, so you need to expand your chest and lock your muscles, pectoral muscles on side, so that you're creating the space for the lungs to breathe. So that's the difficult part of it. And this is a shot of, once you are into space, this is the transporter in which the crews go, and this is a shot taken from the laboratory, which this transporter is about to dock. The docking assembly is over here, and these are the radar antennae, which are constantly mapping the distance and checking out whether the docking procedure is going as per plan. If it is not, then you take over from the computers and complete the docking maneuver manually. Once this docks in, this hatch opens inwards, as does a hatch on the laboratory, and creates a tunnel through which the crew transfers into the laboratory. This is just giving you an idea of how yoga was carried out in space for the very first time, and I trained as per the yogic method to see whether it holds the answer to space sickness, how to ward off space sickness. This just gives you an idea of how life is lived in orbit. There is Yuri Malashev. Of course, it's a very messy place because everything is absolutely flying around over here, and the biggest problem is housekeeping, and you keep getting in each other's way, which is why you need to have compatible crews. Dinner is in progress over here, and I'm upside down. Yuri is right side up, but it makes no difference because there is no up or down when you're in space. And all you need to do is, we had 80 dishes to choose from. You choose what you want to eat, and then put it into this oven over here, heat it up, and there's a hot meal. Except that in between, when you transport the spoon to your mouth, you cannot keep this tin down, otherwise you have your dinner flying away from you. You know? So there are these elastic straps over here, and you stick it down there. Just to give you an idea of what the view is from there, it's a beautiful sight, absolutely. These are clouds, you can see it from the solar panel, which is blocking the view. And here's another shot, once again, the solar panel, which is here. And this is the shot of over a lake. Now, here is the beginning of a fascinating sight when you're in near-Earth orbit. It's dark, and suddenly you find that your solar panels start looking golden. And while you're still looking at this beautiful sight, you see the rim of the Earth like a blue band, and very soon it goes through the spectrum blue, green, yellow, and before you know it, it is sunrise. It's a small little spot of light. Now, this really, in essence, is, and if you miss it, there's no problem, because then 90 minutes later you can see another sunrise, and 40 minutes later you can see a sunset, which is the same beautiful sight except that it's in reverse. At the end of it, we just collected all our stuff, all the data back, and started returning back to Earth. And you are probably able to see this little spot, that is the capsule. All that is left because as soon as fuel keeps finishing, you keep jettisoning all the extra mass. And it's black because it has burnt itself up during re-entry. And fortunately, the heat shield's job is to keep the heat out. And the last 30,000 feet of the descent is under a parachute. Now, this is where we return back. And if I say that it was a wonderful journey, I say it because it is something one has never seen, nor likely to see again, at least in my case, because I'm not a career astronaut. But I would like to convey to you some of the impressions of my fellow astronauts. This is Ronald Evans, who says that as I orbited the moon and the moon was in turn orbiting around the Earth, I could watch the Earth change from three quarters to one half and down to a crescent. Edgar Mitchell, suddenly from behind the rim of the moon, there emerges a sparkling blue and white jewel, a light, delicate sky blue sphere, rising gradually like a small pearl in a thick sea of black mystery. It takes more than a moment to realize this is Earth home. This is a shot taken from the surface of the moon. Gus Grissom, there is a clarity, a brilliance to space that simply does not exist on Earth. Even on a cloudless summer's day in the Rockies, and nowhere else can you realize so fully the majesty of our Earth and be so awed at the thought that it's only one of untold thousands of planets. Joseph Allen, astronaut, the way to find the Earth in the dark is to track the stars until the stars stop. When the stars stop, that's the Earth blocking the light. Now I have conveyed all of this to you just to underline the beauty of the planet we are staying on. And also now, to think through with you what globalization is doing to this planet Earth. All the economies are integrated, we are all interconnected now. And globalization, I think, will ensure that Earth's eco-degradation will continue. Richard Barrett is the values coordinator of the Department of Institutional Change and Strategy, World Bank, Washington. He is the author of a book, which is A Guide to Liberating Your Soul, and founder of the Spiritual Unfoldment Society. I'd like to share some of the lines he has put in that book. He says, "I believe that the value system of our Western civilization is destroying the life support systems of the planet and condemning hundreds of millions of people to poverty. Environmental destruction and social disintegration are capturing the headlines around the world. We are living in a world where the environment is seen as an economic resource to be plundered and discarded, a world where species are becoming extinct at a faster rate than ever before in the history of humanity. A world where the gulf between the rich and the poor continues to grow, and a world where the basis of every negotiation is, what's in it for me? We are all accountable to what is happening to our planet, and it is time that we also become responsible." Now, do you take what Timothy Worth has to say? He's the United States Undersecretary of State for Global Affairs, clearly linked environmental destruction with economic survival. He put it this way. Now, I'm bringing these Americans here only because I want to have you join me in wondering why is it that America is then standing and not letting reforms happen in the environmental sense. Whether it is Cancun, whether it is Brazil, it's just that we are not making progress to ensure that our planet remains green and habitable. So Timothy Worth says that the economy is a wholly owned subsidiary of the environment. When the environment is finally forced to file for bankruptcy because its resource base has been polluted, degraded, and irretrievably compromised, then the economy will also go bankrupt with it. True. At this point, I would like to take you on another wonderful journey to share with you the concerns which I had said of other astronauts and cosmonauts, and let you know how bad the situation really is. Here we go.
The biggest surprise came at the end of the ascent when you go from 3 Gs to 0 G in about one heartbeat. It seemed that way to me. Being on the mid-deck, I couldn't watch gauges or anything, so we were being pressed in the seat at 3 Gs, and then all of a sudden, nothing. And that was a tremendous surprise. I mean, I knew it was going to happen, and I knew what it was going to feel like, but it was unbelievable.
And suddenly it's very quiet. And you're actually inverted because the shuttle arrives in space upside down. And there's this abrupt transition which gives you this feeling that you've gone into a dream. And because it's so quiet and it's hushed and everybody's looking at everybody and almost as if they've all entered this dream state.
Valery, my commander. Well, he was already swimming across the cabin. I thought it looked very simple, so I tried it too. When I pushed away from the chair, I went out much too fast, and I flipped upside down, and I just, well, I was caught against the window, and then I was bouncing up and down, and I didn't know which way was up.
Well, there was one particular moment in my flight, which is one of those moments which you never forget, and that's the moment when, about 10 minutes after liftoff, unstrapped out of the seat and had to go to the bathroom, and the bathroom of the shuttle is placed such that you put a curtain around you, basically, and you do that right next to the door through which you entered, and in that door is a small window about this size. So I looked through that window, and that was my first time that I looked at Earth from the outside.
First glance, I looked at the Earth, and I saw the blue color of the Earth, the curvature of the Earth. I said something that in Arabic would mean Subhanallah, meaning God is great.
I'm not much of a classical music buff, but I spent time looking out the windows, watching the earth go by, and listening to classical music. There was something about coupling those two, the music and watching the world go by, that was perfect.
The fascinating moment starts when you start to relax completely. And if you do that, you forget your limbs, you forget your position of your limbs, and you forget the position actually of your body. You can look outside of the window, relax your whole body, feel completely comfortable, and you're only mind which looks outside, and you've lost your idea about your body. This was the grandest feeling I ever had in my entire life. I never felt this again because I never had to walk out in space after that. But to see it once, the blue earth, the black sky, many stars, and a bright sun. This is really impossible. But I saw it.
My native language to describe it, but donc vous avez une diversité pratiquement infinie de couleurs, et sans.
You have an almost infinite variety of colors. None of the colors are dull, and all awaken something in you.
C'est difficile à exprimer, mais c'est vraiment ce que vous ressentez quand vous êtes.
It's difficult to express, but that's really what you feel when you're in space.
Впечатление было, что я оторвался от земли, оторвался от тяготения этого. Вот легкость какая-то.
My impression was that I had pulled free of the earth, of its gravitational pull.
И вы знаете, вот этот прилив, как.
I felt a lightness in my soul, an amazing lightness of the soul, which you can't feel on earth. And well, actually, I felt a love for all the inhabitants of the earth. I just wanted to love them all.
Told myself, Bobo, now you're going to do better than just say it's wonderful. And I opened up the tape recorder and I started talking. And if you hear what came out, it is just wonderful.
Space, when you looked out, you began to realize the immensity of the scale on which things are. And then you begin to wonder as to why we can't understand that this home planet of ours is so important, and one must look after it, because it isn't, because there's nothing for miles and miles around. It isn't as if you can pull out your roots and move away tomorrow, so that becomes all the more important.
Моё отношение к Земле после длительного пребывания в космосе.
After spending so much time in space, my attitude towards the Earth did change.
Как и младенца.
I began to feel pity for
маленького ребенка.
The way you feel pity for a newborn baby.
На нашу прекрасную планету.
It's very painful to look at our beautiful planet, especially those parts of it which have been hurt by human activity.
You
take the Amazon rainforests, for example. The destruction of these forests should worry all of us.
One of the things that we could see fairly clearly from Lunar orbit is the burning of the Amazon jungle. It's very apparent from Lunar orbit where people are clearing out the jungle, burning down the jungle.
What happens is that the plume of smoke expands as it rises into the atmosphere. And when you go over that part of the continent, you suddenly see this pall of smoke that is covering literally hundreds of thousands of square miles. And it hits you in a very dramatic way, that somehow you get the feeling they're incinerating the entire, that part of the planet.
Our commander, Paul Weitz, had flown on Skylab ten years earlier. And he said that as he looked out the window, he said the atmosphere, the Earth, is more gray and less blue than it was 10 years ago.
И она составляет очень маленькую величину.
The atmosphere is very small.
Мирозданием.
Very thin.
Которая окружает нас.
Compared to the universe that surrounds the Earth.
Это тонкость.
It made me feel that the Earth is very fragile.
Породил у меня чувство хрупкости.
That it's unprotected.
Незащищенности нашей Земли.
The atmosphere is a great shield for the Earth.
Это великий щит.
Because thanks to the atmosphere, we can live.
Благодаря атмосфере.
And thanks to the atmosphere, we don't get burned by radiation from space.
С других миров.
But it's very small.
И такая тоненькая.
It's very thin.
Что я забеспокоился.
And it worried me.
Забеспокоился.
It worried me.
Going over Africa, you're aware of the advancing desertification of that continent. Lakes are getting smaller. Lake Chad, for example, which is well documented as having been a very large lake 25 years ago, is now very, very much smaller. It's 10 times smaller in terms of surface area. The desert is advancing in that part of the world.
We did take some pictures of river systems. And when the lighting was right, you could see that some of these river systems, particularly in the third world, were running very, very heavy with sediment from bad land use practices.
In some cases, after the forests have been cut down, what happens is that the topsoil is eroded, and it flows into the rivers and then eventually into the ocean. And in some cases, this red topsoil literally looks like blood draining into a blue ocean. That kind of destruction of our planet can only go on for so long before it becomes a very hard place to live on.
Dass auch den Widerspruch, dass die Menschen eine
Weltraumtechnik. We still have the contradiction that people are technically advanced. They can go into outer space.
Moralisch doch
zurück. But somehow morally they're backward.
Können die Menschen alles tun?
On one hand, people can do everything.
Sind sie auch
and on the other hand, they are able to destroy the Earth. And I was really moved by that.
From the distance of the moon, which of course is almost a quarter of a million miles away, the Earth is a tiny object. And for some reason, I don't know why, that tiny, bright, shiny little Earth projects a quality of great fragility. You have the feeling that it's something that could be broken easily, and something that we should nurture and care for a lot more than we're doing so far. When the Earth pops up over the lunar horizon, It always surprises you. I mean, even though you have a piece of paper that says it's scheduled to be there, nonetheless, when it first pops up, it comes as quite a surprise. And the nicest image that I have in my mind of the flight of Apollo 11 is that time when Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin were right in front of me in the lunar module, and then simultaneously the Earth popped up right behind them so that I could say to myself, well, look, that's all there are. There they are. 3 billion people there and 2 people there, and that's all there are.
One of the things that is so different about a lunar mission than an Earth orbit mission is that you get to see the Earth as an entirety. And I felt that this is really a very small planet that we live on. It's so beautiful. It looks so fragile in the starkness of space, almost like it shouldn't be in these stark surroundings here. But it's here, and you know it's home. You feel that kinship. You feel that bond.
Below that thin atmosphere is all of life that we know, everything, birth and death and dance and song and pain and sorrow, children playing, all of that is on that sphere.
You get this feeling when you're up in space that you're not looking at Earth for your own benefit, but you're actually, as an astronaut or cosmonaut, being there, Earth is using your eyes as a mirror to look at itself. So that's why I always felt that you could never send a satellite or anything up there to give you an accurate reading of what's happening to Earth. You have to go as part of Earth.
There's one proverb came to my mind, 地球美景,我见如林. And the proverb basically says, I'm basically as a person who has done harm to the system, but when I have for the first time seen it and I recognize my guilt and my essentially my responsibility, and I will do reverse my course from this point on, I will take care of it.
I don't really think the Earth cares what we do to ourselves. I think it's up to us to care what we do to ourselves. If we want to stay here, we better make it someplace that's okay for us to live, someplace where we can thrive. If we make ourselves extinct, some other life form will come up and they'll be the head tenants in charge here. And the Earth doesn't care.
It's quite clear that this animal called man, this species, has the power to wreak a lot of havoc, and I think perhaps has the power collectively to also preserve and to correct some of these mistakes. And it's such a pretty planet. It really is worth the effort.
The one thing I got from my experience in space was the realization that this whole thing, our existence, it's difficult to think that it was all an accident, you know, that one does get the feeling that it was created, that there is a creator.
After my return on Apollo 14, I gave a speech at the United Nations. And I expressed then the thought that if the delegates to this body could have just seen the Earth from the perspective that I did at the lunar distance, it would certainly have an impact on the delegates and would certainly help solve the problems of how we can all come together and live on the only planet that we'll ever have.
After having seen the film, I've got just a few more slides, and we would like to consider what the future is like. These are facts which I'm going to tell you, that the human population has quadrupled in the previous century. Food requirements have increased, and this is leading to bad land use practices. Industrialization is now polluting our water bodies, and the increasing purchasing power results in affluent, energy-intensive lifestyles. Energy sources which are being utilized are non-renewable. Now, nuclear power may not be the answer because of the hazardous toxic waste problem. Consumerist culture today is taking root. Markets are being flooded with products that are not green. Polluting industries are relocating eastwards due to the absence of environmental regulation. And as urban employment opportunities grow, like I've already mentioned, the purchasing power of the population is increasing. Obviously, everybody now wants to have a two-wheeler or a car. So you can imagine how, especially the densities in this area, say India and China, and that is where all the business is also moving, whether it is outsourcing. So the purchasing power of thousands of people are going up, and their lifestyles, these are all polluting lifestyles, whether it is energy, whether it is pollution which is being generated. So excuse, we'll have to go through this. It's a bit of a glitch. So the fact is that we all breathe the same air, and that pollution travels freely across borders. It's no respecter of borders. The environment of planet Earth is the common concern of each of us. We all stand to lose equally. And our choices, like our resources, are limited. We need to conserve our resources so that what we have left lasts longer. We need to protect the environment of planet Earth for our children and for the children of their children. And should we fail, these affluent lifestyles will cause rapid depletion of Earth's non-renewable resources. We will need to find another home. Space research is having funding problems. This is also a fact. Government support is drying up. Private industry is taking over. This has already begun. And if that should happen, we will need, when we relocate to another planet, we will need to buy our seat at an unaffordable price to go live on some other planet. And if we have to do that, my question is, will we carry our small minds in our big spacecraft while we relocate? And once there, then will we reinvent gunpowder to start the cycle again? So we need to look beyond state or national interests and develop a global approach we need to be reborn as world citizens. I'm told that people in very deep meditation states describe their experience as one in which there is no time and no sense of space. More than that, there is a unity, and in very high states of consciousness, there is the experience, not that I am in the universe, but the whole universe is within me. All this is pointing towards a new conceptualization of reality. We are not there yet, but I think we are just seeing the pieces. What I'm interested really is to know how these pieces are going to fit. And it's just not just of academic interest. I think the reason why this real shift needs to happen is because the old materialistic paradigm is ruining our world today. I think it is this mode of consciousness that is leading us to destroy our environment, destroy our habitat, and also destroy the very quality of our own lives. I also think it's really important that we begin to make this shift in ourselves. Again, this is what all the spiritual teachings have been saying. The real challenge is to carry out one's spiritual practice and finally arrive at the awareness that consciousness is fundamental and that everything else is a creation within this consciousness. With all the science and sophisticated technology that we have developed, there is increasing unrest and conflicts and wars in the world, reflecting our own inner chaos and disharmony. For example, if you take the year 1998, the world saw 26 interstate wars and 23 million refugees. Is this progress? I mean, in a final sense, the world has always been saved not by wars and our military leaders, not by our scientists and technologists, not by our industrial magnates, not even by our politicians, certainly not by our politicians, but by our saints and spiritual leaders who have impeccable integrity, and which is why we are here. So we are living in this world where we are spending millions of dollars per day in research and development. I'm sure you, like me, are wondering, why doesn't some of this money go into researching the human mind? It is only then can we continue to live in peace and harmony on this wonderful planet of ours. Thank you.
Thank you, Rakesh Sharmaji. Now, I would like to have very limited questions since we are running out of time.
Experiment designed by our Indian aeromedical experts, and the aim was to find out whether yoga affords an alternative methodology to prepare space crews to better adapt to zero gravity. So this was as about 3 months before the launch, I stopped my fitness schedule as it was given by the Soviets, and I started doing only yoga. And I found that I was none the worse for that, and I adapted fairly well to zero gravity. But to say whether yoga as an experiment was successful would be premature, because the sample data is not statistically valid. Reason being, not everybody gets hit by symptoms of space sickness, so perhaps I was one of those guys who would not have had a problem even if I hadn't done yoga. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, it's something like that. What happens is that because you're weightless, you're unable to maintain your local vertical. So you've got these semicircular canals which really supposed to tell you your vertical, and they are mutually perpendicular, so your head moves in all directions, as a result of which they get overactivated, and the symptoms you get is feel kind of feverish, you feel nausea,
and you don't feel too good. So as a, it's a second order effect. Because you're not feeling too good, then you're kind of dysfunctional.
Hello. Yeah, it is a really a wonderful time to see you and listen to you today, and it will be a memorable day in my life. And I just want to ask you, can you tell any memorable time or moments you have shared with Kalpana Chawla?
Well, unfortunately not. I have not had the chance to meet her ever. I've never met her. Had never met her. In fact, on two separate occasions, we were supposed to meet. On the first time, after her first space flight, she was supposed to come back to India, but that didn't happen because there was a mishap during that flight as well. That one satellite went, which was being deployed, kind of spun out of control. So there was an inquiry for that, which is why she couldn't make it to India. And the second time, of course, because of that accident. No, I have not met Kalpana Chawla, though I really admire all that she has done. And we are very sorry not to have her amidst us today.
I am going to say a few words about Rakesh Sharma. We first met in 1987. I had done operation on his chief for a pancreatic tumor. He wanted to spend a weekend at Ozer. I said, I have no time. He said, but on Shrikhande, you can meet Rakesh Sharma personally. I found time immediately, and from that time we have met. I'll tell you two or three things that he has never taught, told you just now. He said he is neither a scientist nor a spiritual man. I disagree with you. I'll tell you why. When the spacecraft took up, his pulse rate was 68. And the other two persons in the spacecraft, their pulse was 110 and 94. Here is the Indian person, his pulse rate was only 68. This must have come only through physical and spiritual training.
Well, it certainly came through detachment. I didn't care what was going to happen.
Not to carry is equanimity of mind. And remember one thing, all great people whom I met are very humble, the rest are humbug. The difference between L and G. Point number two, he lost his daughter in Moscow when he was being trained for the spacecraft, but the personal tragedy did not come in his way. Now tell me, is it not spiritualism? How many of us can do it? It does not come only through meditation. It comes through some tremendous commitments in life. People can do yoga courses, go for meditation, sit for 1 hour. When time comes, you fail. It requires very superior minds to absorb shocks in lives. Third point he told me, that everybody who has gone to space has fallen in love with Earth. People who go in space never talk of Star Wars. People start talking Star Wars in Washington, London, and Moscow. The farther away you go from your Earth, the more in love your country. Like, you go away from India, you start loving India. And as a surgeon who enters the body every day, I fall in love with the body. My God, how fantastic it is. From a distance, they see that we are destroying the earth. We see deserts are being created. When I go inside, I find how people destroy their livers. They see deserts from the space. I see broken down people inside their minds. I think in the end, they'll come to the conclusion that science and spiritualism are not two separate things. They are all in one. I think yesterday you said something nice, Mr. Karthikeyan. Why divide which is all only one? So I think he's a remarkable man with all his humility. And I'm glad, without asking a single question, say, yes, Dr. Shrikhande, I will come, and he's with us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Could you kindly repeat the words you told Prime Minister Indira Gandhi, and why did you say that?
Well, the words were not mine. I wanted to set the record straight. You know, Professor Swami was saying that. The words were Sare Jahan Se Acha, and this was the response which I gave when the then Prime Minister asked me while I was in orbit as to how India looks from space. Now, these words, as you know, belong to a poem written by Muhammad Iqbal, the great poet.
Yeah.
And I uttered these words because they just seemed to fit. Firstly, because it was always my favorite song when I was in school as a student. We used to, in those days, sing this song along with the national anthem. And it just seemed to capture that moment. But literally, too, I would say both India and the African continent are very pretty sights from space. Reason for India being so is that when most of our orbital path is invariably from south to north, and so you approach India, the whole peninsula with the lovely blue sea and the coastline absolutely clear, and then you come through the southern part, which is green, and then you move into the Deccan area and central India, which the patches of brown, then the deserts, which appear golden from that height. Again, you move into the Gangetic Plain, which is green. Then you move further up towards the Himalayas, which appear purple with snow-capped mountains. So it really is a beautiful sight. But India is beautiful, as you know, for more ways than one, not only its sight. Thank you very much.
May I request B.K. Pramila to give a vote of thanks.
Om Shanti. The first thanks goes from all of us to our most beloved incorporeal Supreme Father, Lord Shiva, who is staying beyond the space, but very right into all of our hearts. And the next immediate thanks goes to our organization, who has brought scientist and spiritualist together in true sense. We do conduct so many conferences, seminars, and dialogues, but this is the gathering of scientists and spiritualists in a true sense. And as after hearing to Dr. Shrikhande, I was very much sure to give my point. I had thought before only, but there was one small, rather joke, which I read in the newspaper long back. One American came to Himalaya, and he saw one yogi sitting with beard, and he was in search of peace. He came to him and asked, "Can I know how to get the peace of mind?" He said, "Why you are coming to me? I'm an American, you go to Indian." But I will correct this joke. If somebody asks, I will say, "You go to Mr. R.K. Sharma. He will be a best person than even the spiritualist to guide for the mental peace." And I'm not exaggerating, but I'm 100% sure that he will be a guideline for all of us, how to guide the people for mental peace and reunion with the Supreme. Next thanks goes to our Professor Mr. Swaminathan, who represented the teacher, incorporeal Supreme Father, giving definition and the know-how of Raja Yoga. In the evening, we are going to experience it. The theory we will be studying throughout the day. And to conduct the whole program, in a very lively way, Mr. Nandakumar, Brahma Kumar Nandakumar, my wholeheartedly thanks goes on behalf of all of us to Brahma Kumar Nandakumar in conducting such beautiful session. And once again, let me thank all the people coming from Mount Abu, our headquarters. By staying here, they are contributing the subtle purity vibrations and the loveful, purposeful, meaningful bonds of love between the soul and the supreme soul. And next thanks goes to all the people who are managing to make this program such glorified. Thank you very much for giving me the opportunity to speak in front of you. And thanks to brother that I got such luck to be here with him, to give some thanks to him. I request Sister Usha Behan to go ahead with the beautiful ceremony of giving the gifts to our respected guest. And we will join with our big hands to our brother, Sri Rakesh Sharma, respected Professor Swaminathan, he is also a Brahma Kumar, and our secretary, Nanda Kumar. Thank you very much.